What's up, what's up, what's up? What is going on out there, everybody? You're listening to Expanded Perspectives with me, Cam Hell. And joining me, as always, es mi amigo, Mr. Kyle El Wapo Filson.
Hello, everybody. How's it going?
And we've got a great treat for you today. We did a jam-up interview with Mr. Jim Tucker. We're going to be speaking about past lives and reincarnation as told through the mouths of children. And if anything, if you've seen any of the shows, I believe it's called Ghost Inside My Child.
Yeah,
that's something that'll kind of spur your memory or give you an idea of kind of like what this is about. But Jim's done a badass job of doing a lot of research. He's written two books. We're going to get into that. And so it was a great interview, and it's something that me and Kyle really enjoyed. For all of the new listeners out there that have joined us, that have found us some other podcasts, and by other podcast I mean maybe recently from Jim Harold's podcast, thank you so much for coming
Absolutely.
Over here.
Thank you.
And hanging out
Welcome
with us.
Welcome to the show if you're new. If you're a returner.
Hey, yeah. If you're old
Welcome
school,
back.
What's going on, guys? If you're part of the tribe, what's happening?
If you are new, though, what does this show focus on, Cam?
Well, man, we love to talk about ancient history. We love to talk about crypto. We've done ufology, conspiracy theories, pretty much anything paranormal, anything strange and unusual. Yeah, that's what Kyle and I really kind of enjoy, so... You know, I mean, hell, he even brought up an exorcism on the last one, guys, and trying to scare me, I guess. I don't know. But yeah.
Yeah, speaking of that, I got an email from somebody showing that, what's his name? Zach Baggins? Is that his name?
Yeah.
From Ghost Adventurers.
Is that what it is?
I don't know. It's one of those shows on sci-fi. I don't really watch them either, but apparently he bought that house. Remember on the last episode I was talking about the lady who was possessed?
Yeah.
The old 9-year-old was walking
backwards
up the
wall. He bought that house?
That's what it says. He bought that house, the one in Gary, Indiana. What was her name? Latoya Amons or something. I don't have it in front of me. That house, apparently they moved out, and he bought the house. So maybe...
He's going to do an ongoing investigation
there? I hope so. These shows, you know, Finding Bigfoot, these ghost shows, it's the same thing. They go to someplace creepy, and then like they're like, we got to move on. There's some stuff going on here. I mean, why did they leave?
Stay there.
Yeah. So apparently he bought this place, and maybe we'll get to see some new footage or something out of there.
I hope so. That would be really
interesting. But back to your campfire stories.
Oh, yeah. Hey, guys. Yeah. If you... Like we said, if it's the older listeners and you're not aware of what happened, Kyle and I interviewed Jim Harold a few weeks ago, and he's going to be coming up on the show. But I had told him a story that had happened to me when I had spoke to my grandfather. And anyway, you'll hear it when it comes up in the interview. But he really wanted me to tell that story on his show. So I agreed. So if you go to iTunes or to Podbay or go to anywhere that you get it, Stitch or anything like that, that Jim's on, and you search up Jim Harold's Campfire Stories, and you go to episode 175, and it's called Grandma Pays a Visit. I'm the very first one on there, so you can listen to
the story.
I think
it's the newest one.
It is, I believe. I believe it's the
newest
one.
Because I know it came out last week.
Yeah. So if anybody wants to listen to that, y'all can go and listen to it. Or if you don't want to, you can just wait till it comes out on ours, because I pretty much tell. I don't really go into the detail on our show that I do with Jim, but I really enjoyed being on there. And Jim is such an awesome
guy.
He
has several podcasts. The Paranormal podcast, and then the Campfire Stories. What I like about it is it's actually listeners that call in and tell their renditions.
That is pretty
awesome.
Experiences,
and that's a really unique approach. I've never seen another podcast where it's nothing but the listeners calling in and these stories. And then what's his third podcast?
About podcasting.
It's a podcast.
It's like a webinar or something,
something like that. How to Begin Podcasting. So if you listen to this show and you're like, man, you know, I've always wanted to have a podcast, and I've got a buddy. Maybe we can get one going. Go to Jim, man. He does the step-by-step. Tutorial on how to do it. They didn't have that when we started.
No, they didn't have. I mean, we spent hours and hours because Kyle and I are both barely literate as it is. So we spent hours on the internet.
That's right. I mean, there's so many videos on YouTube and stuff, and everybody is doing it a little different. Even guys I know now that are pretty big names, they do it different than we do.
Yeah, we've talked to.
So there's no one right way to do it.
We've had some in-depth conversations with probably half a dozen of the large paranormal podcasts that we're friends with, and each one does it differently.
Yep.
So it's one of those things.
I mean, like one of the sticklers people complain about sometimes with our show is that the file sizes are too big.
Yes.
We've tinkered with it, man, and done it the ways others have told us, and it never comes out right, I don't think.
And I'm not willing to give up that, folks. I mean, it's going to be a little bit larger
file size. I mean, I think quality,
size,
audio quality is paramount. I mean, if you have a device and my file size is way too big for your device, then maybe you need a new device. I don't know what to tell you. Or delete some of the old stuff off there. You don't got to keep every show we have. Delete it. Only keep the new one, you know?
I keep the freshest shows of all the ones I listen to because of that reason. Because I'm always afraid I'm going to be like, you know, when you need it?
Yeah.
You're like, I'm trying to download it. You're like, no, there's not enough. And I'm fixing to take a road trip. So, yeah, I need all the space tore up out of mine.
That's right.
That
you're going
use.
Skiing in Colorado.
I'm going to Colorado.
Man,
yeah.
Have you been watching the Winter Olympics? I'm pumped.
Yes.
I love I like the Winter Olympics more than the Summer Olympics by far. I just like, I like cold weather. I skiing and shooting stuff. Yes, I like snowboarding myself and skiing. And of course, ice hockey, that's my favorite. I'm really jammed up for the men's to start.
Sochi seems a little bit run down. Like, it doesn't seem finished, does it?
Yeah, it's a lot.
I don't want to pick on the dudes because I know there's a lot of work to put that thing on, but I noticed
$51 billion.
You look at some of the photos and you're like, man, guys, first of all, for those that don't know, I work for the municipality here in the city that we broadcast out of, and I have for about 10 years now, and dealt with water, wastewater, with everything. So when I see people with manhole covers off in the street, it's not just a joke. That's something that can claim a life at the easiest. I mean, you're talking about, you step off in there, you're dead. I mean, we're not talking a shallow sewer line. We're not talking 3 or 4 feet.
Those How far does it go down? I mean, I don't know.
Well, it depends on the lake because it all runs with gravity. It's a gravity flow. So it depends on the size of the hill it's on, things like that. So to make it flow, so it's not flat. So some of the mains at the top of the hill could only be, you know, 3 foot deep. But at the bottom of that hill, so it continues to fall with grade, could be 10 or 12 foot deep.
Hmm.
You walk off in that, my friend, and fall and snap an ankle down there and have the poo water get
running
all over you.
What's interesting is it looks like, I mean, they've done a jam-up job. The buildings and stuff are awesome. But it looks like if you just go 3 or 4 blocks away from me in that structure, it's like completely different world.
Or it's just the outside's finished. And you walk on the inside
like they do in North Korea, right?
That's exactly what I was going with. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that was great. But, yeah, folks, whatever you're doing, keep it up, man. Our numbers are growing. If you're telling your friends, everybody that's finding us, we really do appreciate it. It's great. I mean, we're just, the family is growing. I'm getting where I don't have enough arms to hug everybody out
there.
Yeah,
no, it's growing. We're getting more input from everybody. We're getting more emails from people. It's fantastic.
It's great.
Let's get into tonight's interview.
Yeah, let's lay it down on them, man. This was fun.
I'm fascinated with this subject. Dr. Jim Tucker, he's got two books out. One is called Life Before Life, and the new one is called Return to Life, I believe.
I believe you're right.
And Jim Tucker is a medical director of the Child and Family Psychiatry Clinic and associate professor of psychiatry and neurobehavioral sciences at the University of Virginia. His main research happens to do with reincarnation mm-hmm. of children. There's numerous cases where children at an early age, like 2 or 3 years old, will have information that is completely unknown. I mean, there's no way they could know.
You can't make it up.
I mean, like one boy I'm thinking of off the top of my head.
Don't give it away.
Okay.
Stop.
All right.
Just stop till they hear it.
But it's incredible. Yeah. And not just are they memories, they actually have birthmarks. So like a kid will get strange pattern of birthmarks and they'll ask him and he goes, oh yeah, when I was before I got shot, you know. And then it's almost as if like when the memory starts fading, the birthmarks fade away. I mean, it's fascinating.
Some strange things, yeah.
And I think he says they have like over 1,500 cases. So
And it's not just, I mean, it's from all over. It's from America. I mean, it's from all around the world he's taking these cases. So.
Right. Dr. Tucker, he's a board-certified child psychiatrist, and he's worked several years with Ian Stevenson before he retired, and that's how he got on this. We're going to get into it tonight, and he's going to tell us all about it, so I'm really excited.
I completely agree, because I loved it. I loved every minute of it, because it's one of those things that there's really no arguing with it.
There's no way you can explain it.
Yeah.
There's no way.
No.
All right, man. Well, let's get into it. This is Expanded Perspectives. Joining us tonight on Expanded Perspectives is Dr. Jim Tucker. How are you doing, Jim?
I'm doing just fine, thank you.
And we have recently read your book. I read Life Before Life. I haven't had a chance to read your newest one, Return to Life, but it is eye-opening. It's incredible. How did you get started with doing this?
Well, this is work that's been going on at the university for 50 years now. Ian Stevenson was chairman of the Department of Psychiatry here at University of Virginia. When he heard about these cases from various parts of the world of young children talking about past lives, and he was intrigued enough to start investigating, eventually became so interested that he stepped down as chairman to focus on this full time, and we've been going ever since. I got involved in the late 90s. I had trained at the university in psychiatry and child psychiatry. I had heard of Ian Stevenson, but never met him or anything, and then I was in private practice. And then when my wife and I got together, she was open to things like reincarnation and psychic abilities and that sort of thing, which I had never really seriously considered. I started doing some reading, and I happened to be reading one of Ian Stevenson's books when we saw in the local paper that his research division had gotten a grant to do a new study on near-death experiences. And feeling somewhat unfulfilled in my private practice, I called to see if they needed help with that study, just as a sort of a volunteer hobby kind of thing. That got my foot in the door, and I became more interested and eventually gave up my private practice, and I've been here full-time at the university for the last 13 years.
Wow, that is incredible. Now, when you get when people get in contact with you or get in touch with you, how do you go about doing these investigations? Like, are there certain techniques that you use, or how do you I guess the word I'm looking for is, how do you decide what's an actual case and what's just I don't know what I'm trying to ask, but
I understand. As far as what's sort of worth investigating.
Yes.
I mean, what we focus on, or what we try to focus on, are cases where the child has said enough where the statements can potentially be verified. So we get a lot of reports from American parents where the children may have talked quite a few times about a past life, but if they don't give names or places, it's impossible to know if this is just imagination or if they're remembering a past life but just can't give enough details where we can track it down. But then there are the cases where the kids do give names or places, and then we get quite interested. So our task when we go to study a case is to determine as carefully as possible what the child has actually said about a past life, and then to see if, in fact, those statements can be verified and can be shown to match somebody who did live and die before.
Jim, what's all the countries that you've gone to do all of these? I know that you've spoke about going like to Thailand and then into Asia and then also North America. Have you covered several other countries or just like a couple? Or where all have you been?
Well, for me personally, I've done Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, and then the U.S. But cases have been found wherever anyone has looked for them. They've been found on all the continents except Antarctica, where obviously no one has looked.
Yeah.
And you know, there are countries where we haven't essentially had access to, for instance, Vietnam. But then I got an email from someone recently reporting a case in Vietnam. So I think they are, wherever anyone goes looking for them, the cases can be found. And of course, in the U.S., I mean, we're a culture where most people do not believe in reincarnation. And we're certainly hearing from a lot of families that had absolutely no belief in reincarnation before their kids started talking about this.
Well, that's what I was going to ask next. Does it seem like other countries are a little bit more open, or does it seem like the U.S. is getting, like, kind of getting on board? Does it seem like they're getting a little bit more open with the ideas of reincarnation, you think, with your studies?
Well, it's hard to know. I mean, we're certainly hearing from more and more parents, and maybe it's become more open. I mean, polling over the past 30 or 40 years has fairly consistently shown that around 25% of Americans believe in reincarnation. And actually, even 20% of American Christians believe in reincarnation. It's obviously a private belief that they have. So the belief has been out there for some time. Now with the Internet, of course, people can find us a lot more easily. So we are hearing from more American families. But it's really impossible to say if actually more families are experiencing this or if they're just contacting us.
It's funny that you said with the whole Internet deal, because it feels like the freedom of information is making a monumental swing for everybody in every field. It seems like people are getting more and more of that information brought forth to them.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is certainly the information age. And, you know, there's so much that you can study just from your desk that before would have been so much more difficult.
For sure. Is there... I was curious about this because I know you talk about several ages, but does there seem like there is a prime age? Like, if you had to put your finger on it, is it 3 or 4 or 2 or 5? Is there a number that's like the magic number of age of the children?
It's not a magic number, but it's certainly young. The average age when the kids start talking about a past life is 38 months, so usually around the third birthday. Occasionally it'll be a little older, 4 or 5. It'd be very unusual to start after 5, although occasionally it does. But it usually stops, actually, by the age of 6 or 7, as the kids generally stop talking about this stuff, even if they talked about it a lot when they were younger. So there does seem to be a fairly narrow window where this material is coming out.
So it's about the time the child can really start expressing him or herself is whenever they really start letting this out.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there are some kids where it seems like something happens that stimulates the memories, but for many of them, it seems like more or less they've always had the memories, and they just come out once the kids can really verbalize things.
I think the thing that really struck me the strangest was when you were talking about the birthmarks being on these children that could have been from past life accidents of the people that they were talking about, and that when the memories of these past lives start to fade, these birthmarks also start to fade.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, the birthmarks or birth defects even, I mean, they can be permanent. But, yeah, I mean, these are ones that match wounds on the previous person's body, usually fatal wounds. And some of them are really quite traumatic, both in either large or irregular kind of birthmarks or even frank birth defects. So, like a little girl who the previous person had had his fingers chopped off as he was being murdered, and this girl was born of remarkably deformed fingers. So there are these wild cases, and sometimes the birthmarks do change, and sometimes they can fade or even sort of move as the body grows. But they are another piece that seems at least connected to the past life memories.
Yeah, and so for the people out there that don't know what we're talking about, there's these cases where these children begin talking about a past life where they might have been murdered or something like that, say gunshot.
Extreme detail at certain times.
Right, and this child will have birthmarks in the exact same spot where they were shot, if they were in a previous life. And there's some particular cases I'd like to talk about. Now, I'm going to butcher these names because I'm terrible with pronunciation, but there's one that I liked. It was Kanai Kumalaliwong.
Kanai, yeah. Yeah, that's a little boy who... This is one of Ian Stevenson's cases in Thailand, where the boy is born with 2 birthmarks that match wounds. And sort of to tell the story, he around the age of 3 started doing a lot of playing as a teacher, and then said that he had been a teacher in a past life, and said that his name had been Bua Kai, and that he had been shot on the way as he rode his bicycle to school one day, where he was a teacher. He named his parents and said where he had lived before. And eventually his grandmother took him on a bus to near that place. They got off the bus, and he led the way to this house where there was this older couple there, and he seemed to recognize them. And it turned out that they had a son named Bua Kai Lonak, who in fact had been a teacher. And he had been riding his bike to school one day when he got shot and killed about 5 years before Chennai was born. And Ian was not able to find an autopsy report, but the man's widow said that she had been told that they knew he had been shot from behind because he had a small round entrance wound on the back of his head and a larger, more irregularly shaped wound on the front. And Chennai was born with birthmarks that matched both of those. It's this small round one on the back of his head and a larger, more irregularly shaped one on the front. And in fact, Ian found 18 cases of double birthmarks, of kids born with marks that match both the entrance and the exit wounds on the body of the previous person.
That's incredible.
Jim, I was going to ask, do they, in your cases or your studies, have you found that the children seem to maybe exhibit things other than just past lives? Do they ever seem like they, any of them exhibit anything other like an ESP or a psychic ability, or there's anything like that? Or is it just simply recalling the past life?
It's most of the time it's just the past life, but there are exceptions. There are ones where the families feel like the children also have some psychic abilities. And occasionally, there are a couple of cases in my new book where occasionally the kids have fairly significant psychic abilities, you know, which is a whole other topic. But for most of them, they just seem like ordinary kids, except that they remember past lives.
Whenever you write the book on those, we're going to have to get you back on for that one, too.
<You're right.
laughs> What's incredible also is not just the birthmarks that are left, but some of the kids actually reenact the way they died in their previous life. I mean, I read a story about boys reenacting how they were escaping from a sinking boat that they must have drowned in their previous life. Another boy from Lebanon would reenact his suicide by putting a stick mm-hmm. underneath his chin. I mean, it's just incredible. And some of the kids know details that is impossible for them to know about as a 2 or 3 year old. I mean, there was a boy named Carl Eden who remembered being like a German fighter pilot. Can you tell us about him?
Yeah, I mean, that, again, is one of Ian's cases where the child showed a number of sort of traits as far as the things he would like to eat and the things he would do. Unfortunately, that was one where the previous person was never quite identified. But it was a British boy, and he was certainly showing a lot of abnormal kinds of things for his family and for his area. But it wasn't completely verified. But there's a similar case in the U.S., James Leininger, which has gotten a fair amount of press. His parents eventually wrote a book about his experiences. But he also remembered being a pilot. It was an American pilot, but he showed the behaviors like you're talking about. When right after his second birthday, he started having horrific nightmares about a plane crash. 4 or 5 times a week he was having these where he was kicking his legs up in the air and screaming, "Airplane crash on fire, little man can't get out." And during the day, he would take his little toy planes and repeatedly smash them into the family's coffee table. So I saw a picture of the coffee table, and there were dozens of dents and scratches where the kid just repeatedly was saying, "Airplane crash on fire," and slammed the thing into the coffee table. So he really looked like a kid more or less with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, where he was repeatedly acting out this thing, and then talked about the plane crash and said how he'd been a pilot, and he had been, he flew off a boat, and he named the boat, he said it was Natoma, and he said he'd been shot down by the Japanese, and that he'd been killed at Iwo Jima, and he said that he had a friend named Jack Larson on the boat with him. Well, his dad, who initially was very hostile to the idea of reincarnation, started investigating essentially to try to disprove that it meant anything, but eventually discovered that, in fact, there was an aircraft carrier in the Pacific during World War II called the USS Natoma Bay, and it was involved in the Iwo Jima operation. There was only one pilot that was killed from that ship at Iwo Jima, and it was a young man named James Houston. Houston's plane crashed exactly the way that James described. He talked about the plane getting hit in the engine, bursting into flames, the plane crashing into the water and then quickly sinking, and that's exactly what happened to Houston's plane. And on the day of the crash, the pilot of the plane next to his was named Jack Larson, just as James had said. So that was one where we had the behaviors, but we also had a lot of specific details from 50 years before, so it just seems inconceivable that this little 2-year-old could have learned about through any sort of ordinary means.
Yeah, it really does. I mean, how does a 2-year-old not just know, but would know facts about the ship that he was on, you know, intricate details about, I mean, you know, I have a 2-year-old right now. He doesn't know about Japanese and World War II or fighting in a fighter pilot.
He knows Thomas the Train.
Yeah, I mean,
well, that's right. And I mean, for any of us, if we had to guess the name of a U.S. aircraft carrier, I think it'd be a long time before many of us would come up with the word Natoma. And he did it as a 2-year-old.
Yeah, I'm a grown man, and I don't think I could guess a name of a vague name of an aircraft carrier.
Enterprise, Nimitz, or something.
Yeah, I mean, when he said it, his dad's initial reaction was to say, well, that sounds Japanese to me. And the boy said, no, it's American. And, of course, it turned out it was American.
That reminds me, it makes me think of one of the stories from your book, Jim, that you were talking about. I believe there was a boy whose father was going to be redeployed, and the little boy took him into his room and set the dad down and talked to the dad like he was a grown man himself, and was talking to him about whenever the bombs fall, you've got to get lower.
I don't think that's one of our cases. I think that's one that was on TV recently.
I remember hearing something about that, but it always makes me think of these boys that come back from war, and it's what led me to the question was, do you have a lot of, do the men come back as boys and the girls come back, or the ladies come back as little girls, or is there sometimes a mix match?
About 90% of the time, the kids talk about a past life as the same sex. So the other 10%, it is a switch. And some of those kids will have gender confusion, where they're showing behaviors more appropriate for the other gender.
Well, that's another question I was going to ask you.
Yeah, and that will sometimes fade as the kids develop, but not always. I mean, there are some cases where Ian followed them into adulthood, and they were still showing what we might call gender dysphoria.
It's got to be terrible for the children. Now, you said that, like, most of them start out growing it by 5 or 6, but I guess the ones that have the gender issues, that could follow them, like you said, into some later on in life.
Yeah, transgender suffer from, you know, past life.
Yeah, and I mean, people have speculated about that. But, you know, if a child doesn't have specific memories, there's certainly no way to know for sure. But the whole issue of the sort of gender dysphoria or transgender issues, yeah, I mean, it's a very complicated area that we don't have a very good understanding of how that occurs. So maybe one factor is that these issues that the child brings with him to this life.
And also I want to point out, too, that a lot of these stories don't have the happy endings, like the kids get to find out who they were and everything goes on. I remember you talking about one, I believe, that recalls being aborted before she was born to another mother.
Well, that's right.
And then it didn't have real a happy ending.
Was that Kendra
ending.
Carter? Was that her name?
I think that's it. Exactly. Yeah. It doesn't have a real happy ending for that one either.
Yeah, tell us about that one.
That was an interesting case, and that was one where the mother was, she hated the idea of reincarnation. In fact, she said she felt like she was committing a sin just to buy a book on the topic.
Wow.
But then, so she had this little girl, and when the little girl was young, she was taking swimming classes. And from the time that she met the teacher, she ran and hopped in her arms and was really loving toward her, which was quite unusual for Kendra. She was usually more standoffish. And then a few weeks after that, she started saying that she had been the teacher's baby, and that she had the teacher had been sick and had pushed her baby out. And she basically was describing an abortion, and her mom asked how she knew all these things about the teacher's baby, and she said, I'm the baby that was in her tummy. And her mom knew that the girl had never been alone with the teacher, and they had certainly, the teacher never talked about having an abortion. But Kendra certainly described going through one, and said how the teacher had allowed a bad man to pull her out, and how she tried to hang on, but she couldn't. Then she described being scared in this dark and cold place afterwards. Eventually, Kendra's mom talked with the teacher about it and found out that, in fact, 9 years before, she had an abortion. But Kendra got remarkably attached to this teacher, and she would only be happy if she was with the teacher. And it got so bad that eventually Kendra spent 3 nights a week overnight with the teacher. And the mom said she hated to allow that, but the girl just wanted to be with this woman so badly. Well, eventually, unfortunately, the teacher and the mom, or fortunately maybe, but the teacher and the mom had a falling out, and the teacher said she didn't want to see Kendra anymore. once that happened, Kendra, according to her mom, literally did not speak for 4.5 months and became profoundly depressed. Eventually, the teacher met with them again, and the girl gradually started talking. But I got follow-up from them. I met Kendra when she was still quite young. She was, I think, maybe 5 or 6. But I got follow-up when she was older, and at that point she had no contact with the teacher, and she was doing fine. But by the time she was 11 or 12, she had completely put that behind her and moved on. But it was certainly a very intense and unique situation when she was younger.
That was the one that I was like, it's got to be hard. Just not for the little girl going through it, but the entire family. I mean, that just rattles the whole family up to the point that, I mean, I can see how the mother would want to be totally against it. Like, she just wants to move on and forget about it, but she really can't.
Well, exactly, and we have similar situations in other families because the child is sometimes crying every night about missing the previous family. Sometimes the child is saying, you're not my parents. My real parents live in such and such place. And it can certainly take its toll on the family. And even if the child isn't being sort of mean to the parents, just the parents having to see the child go through this can be quite difficult. So we reassure them that this will fade away and that the child almost always gets fully connected with this life and then is happy in the family that he or she is in.
Well, so now let me ask you this. Have you been, I'm sure you have, been to several cases to where it's almost like the child may have said a little something and then the parents are kind of leading them along, maybe even subconsciously dropping hints to the children, not even realizing that they're doing it?
Yeah, well, that's coaxing a concern, in the Asian cases where there's a general belief in reincarnation, there are times where the parents are expecting the child to be rebirthed. And especially if there's been, say, a family member that's recently deceased, then, yeah, there is the concern that the parents are sort of making too much over what the child has said and sort of exaggerating it. But then again, we've got a lot of cases where the parents have never given past lives a minute thought and don't even know what to make of it. So there may be some where the parents are sort of leading them on, but then there are a lot where the parents initially just ignore what the child says.
Take a minute while I pull another people again and take a chance to make a person never come across.
One of the, to get off the sad note, one of the funny ones, I believe, was about a man who can't remember his name, but he was actually from Hollywood, and he had been an extra on a movie set. And as the child was like, I don't like this house. It's not big like my house. My house had a swimming pool, and I had a nice place, and was giving the parents like a hard time about it.
Well,
and
exactly.
Then,
yeah,
then with they find out it was real.
That's one of the cases in my new book, and that was one where I was involved from the start because the boy pointed to a man in a picture from an old movie and said, yeah, that was me, and it was an extra with no lines in the movie. So the mom sent it to me to see if I could help identify who that was, and eventually, with the help of a Hollywood archivist, we were able to identify him. But meanwhile, the boy was making all kinds of statements about his life. And they all turned out to be true. I mean, at the time, it seemed unlikely to me that this extra would have had a big house with a swimming pool and had danced in New York and had seen the world on big boats and all these things. But in fact, this guy that he pointed to, in fact, had done all those things.
The whole story, that is just hilarious that he's giving his parents a hard, like, oh, this is nice, but it's not as nice as my old house. And they're like, what are you talking about? And then he goes into the whole deal of it. I'm like, oh, the kid's just giving you a hard time, man. You can't compete with those Hollywood guys.
Well, that's right. But, I mean, it really wasn't funny at the time in the sense that along with those statements, he was crying all the time about missing people from that life. I mean, they were funny elements to it, but it really was quite difficult for the family.
Well, I remember the part of the story is you said they took him to meet his daughter.
Well, that's right.
And it was really, really hard on him.
Yeah, and it was, I think, really awkward for him. But at the same time, I think, and this is often the case, the trip was also therapeutic. It often is when the child sees the previous family and sees the previous place and sees essentially that life has gone on, it validates their memories, but also seems to help them realize that those things are in the past and then move on. In that case, in Ryan's case, the little girl had been 7 or 8 when her father died, but she's now in her 50s, and I think it was really confusing for Ryan, and he said how it didn't seem like he'd been gone that long. In fact, he thought at first people were not telling him the truth that she had aged so much because he thought that she was still young.
That must be so hard on everybody involved, the child especially, if he's got these memories. I can only imagine. It's like he woke up in a dream. This can't be real. I mean, I'm almost glad it fades. I mean, I would not want to go through that. Like, that would be so heartbreaking for your child to be, like you said, he's crying. I mean, yeah, it's funny some of the things that he said, giving everybody, but like you said, he's crying every night. And then whenever you finally, it's going to be hard on the family because the family's like, I want to bring some closure to this, but what's this going to do to my child whenever he goes and meets his child?
Yeah,
or who
exactly.
He thinks is his child.
It can be quite difficult. But in the long run, talking with some of these kids after they've grown up, as some of my colleagues have, some of them say that all in all, it was helpful to them, that it did give them sort of a bigger, larger perspective on life, even though when they were younger, often it was extremely challenging for them.
Now, does it seem like when they come back, do they come back, is it more often, I guess, do they come back in the same family, or do they come back at random?
Well, that's what I was going to ask. Is it regional? I mean, I'm obviously, Carl Eden said he was a boy from Germany. But does it seem like it's regional? I mean, like, if you were to die in this country, it almost seems like you come back in the same country.
Yeah, if he come back as a German, I'd expect him to be able to speak some German.
Or just a couple towns away, or it seems like it's very locational.
Yes, I mean, it's certainly not random in the sense that, you know, of the however many billion people there are in the world, 7 billion, that you could land anywhere. About a quarter of the cases are from the same family. And the vast majority of them are the same country. And usually the ones that are not from the same country, there's still a connection. So, for instance, Ian found a couple of dozen cases in Burma where the children talked about having been a Japanese soldier who was killed in Burma during World War II. So they were recalling life as Japanese, but there was still this Burmese connection. You know, it's a little hard to know what to make of that. I mean, it's hard to imagine that sort of consciousness or spirit or whatever you call it, there would be sort of geographical limitations. But it may be that there's this sort of identification that is strong enough where it then affects what the next life is like. So, you know, many of us certainly identify strongly with being American, so that might make it more likely that in our next life we would also be American.
And it seems like most of the cases are people who died traumatically. In other words, there's not too many cases that I read about where somebody died of old age, like in their 90s and came back. It almost seems like somebody's life was cut short. They're back again because they had unfinished business here.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. About 70% of the cases, the previous person died by unnatural means, meaning either murder, suicide, or accident. And even in the natural cases, people tend to die quite young, so even with the natural ones, a quarter of them died before the age of 15. So, yeah, there is something about dying young or dying violently or suddenly that seems to make this phenomenon more common. And yeah, people have certainly used the idea of unfinished business. And there seems to be something to that, where the consciousness, or whatever you want to call it, has not moved on, but has sort of continued in this world and then continues on in a new life.
Well, I like also in your book, there was a boy named Kenny that was about 9 years old, and he said that a playmate of his died, and he told his mother that he knows it's not good that Greg died, but it's not so bad either. I just wish that his mother knew that it's only Greg's body that is gone, that God expects everyone to go to heaven sooner or later. So it's almost like they had incomplete business, and that's why they came back.
Well, that's right, and we've had other kids say similar things, like, well, it's not so bad if you die, then you get to come back. And, it seems like at least in these cases that, in fact, is what has happened.
I was going to say, it seems like when we were talking about the regional area or something like that, when you're cut short, it's almost like your consciousness or your soul or whatever it is seeking like areas. Like you talked about the Japanese were there in Burma, he never left it. You know, it's just that's the way they felt, like they were just looking for their next ride to get back in that area, kind of like even here. You know, it's just it's kind of funny that you could be born again kind of through another body in an American. If you had died in America real quick, I could kind of understand that. But it's just, it's strange to me, like you're talking about with the German fighter pilot or something being in America. Some of those people like that, I'm almost like, man, how did he find his way over here then?
Well, that's right. I mean, there are exceptions to any of these patterns, and there are ones where, the person seems to have appeared halfway across the world. But with the others, it may be that German pilot is looking for any opening to come through. But it may also be that there is, because of events that happened, there is an emotional connection or emotional pull that leads to the next life. So, say a German pilot who's killed in England, there may be so much emotional baggage sort of wrapped up in the interactions with England that it then leads the next life to take place there.
And I guess, too, it's human nature that we want to try to find a pattern. We want to try to find some sort of reasoning to wrap our heads around, to go, oh, well, if I die here, I'm going to be born back in America. And if you die in Japan, you could be reborn as Japanese. It's just human nature to try to find patterns in things. Is there ever been a case, I know you'd said it had happened to one lady before, but like cases where the children that maybe they could speak other languages. Have you ever had that, to where that they were actually, I wouldn't know, I guess I couldn't say fluent in other languages, but as they learned like English, they also realized they could speak Japanese or could speak German?
Well, there have been a very small number that may shown what we call xenoglossy, speaking an unlearned language. There have also been some where the people around them, like their parents, said that they spoke some sort of language that no one could understand. And then, for instance, in Burma, and then the child talked about being a Japanese soldier. So it may be that the child had spoken Japanese, but there's no way to know because no one around there knew Japanese.
I think Kyle's youngest son speaks a language that nobody understands.
Well, that's right. It can be hard to tell. Yeah, is it really another language the child is speaking, or is it just for gibberish before the child got verbal enough? But there are a very small number where it does look like the child did speak a language that he or she had not learned in this life, so it seemingly came from a past life.
Now, Jim, one of the things I found fascinating in your book, and I was unaware of this until your book, was this experimental birthmarks, where it's like a practice, I wouldn't say common practice, but it's a practice in Southeast Asia and India, Sri Lanka, places like that, where they actually mark the death of somebody with like some kind of mark, and then to see if they would regenerate somewhere later?
Yeah, exactly. It's where after somebody dies, family members or friends will take usually like soot from the bottom of a rice pot or some paste or something and make a mark on the body and sort of say a prayer or make a wish that the individual take that mark with them to their next life so that they can be recognized, so that people know who they are. And it's usually done with the expectation it'll be in the same family, although it doesn't have to be. Ian had found 20 cases like that, and then a colleague and I found 18 more. And these kinds of things had been reported before, not often, but have been reported. In fact, the Dalai Lama in his autobiography talks about how one of his brothers died, and then a family member took a pat of butter and marked the body with that, and then subsequently there was another brother who was born with a pale birthmark in that spot. So those are interesting cases.
Yeah, I mean, they claim to be somebody from a previous life, and they actually have the marking that somebody put on them.
That's right, and yeah, you can sort of imagine, well, how in the world did that get transferred over? But
yeah.
I would think perhaps it's the sort of the prayer or the mental wish that the marker makes, and somehow that connects with the consciousness and then affects the developing fetus so that the mark is there when the child is born.
Wow. The next thing I would ask you is these stories of divine intermission, like where these people are almost like waiting in a waiting room almost, and they're wanting to come back to Earth, and they actually talk about their time when they're in that waiting place.
Well, that's right. With our kids, about 20% of them will talk about events between lives. And some of them will talk about earthly events, like they'll describe the funeral, seeing the funeral that the previous person had. And in fact, there's one little girl in Thailand that Ian studied where she complained that her ashes had been scattered rather than buried the way she'd wanted. And she made a lot of statements. And anyway, the previous person, when she had died, she had asked that her ashes be buried under the Bo tree of the temple complex where she studied. But when her daughter went to do that, the root system of the tree was so extensive she couldn't bury them, so she scattered them instead. So there are cases like that where they talk about events that can actually be verified to have happened. But then there are other kids that will talk about going to other realms like heaven, and the American kids may use the word heaven. And then some of them will talk about either choosing their next parents or being led to their next parents, and then continuing on with a new life. And you're right, some of them essentially describe a waiting room where they're a collection of souls waiting to be reborn, and then often how they see their future parents and choose to be born to them.
I think it's funny that you bring that up, Jim, with the waiting room, is all the notes and the reading and stuff we've done on all of this. It seems like you were talking about the man whenever he went to see, the little boy went to see his daughter and she was like in her 50s, and then the waiting room. It's like we are the only things that really keep up with time. Outside of this consciousness, time means nothing. And it seems like these people, like he's like, oh, I can't believe I was gone that long. You know, it's just a few minutes maybe in his mind, and then he's back here in a small child's body. Almost right away in that whole waiting room thing.
I think, yeah, I mean, the waiting room thing, I must say, sort of an odd image, but you're right that time, if it exists on other planes or whatever you want to call it, there's no reason to think that it's synchronous with our time.
Mm-hmm.
It's two very different existences.
I guess the waiting room thing, I like the idea of it. I like the idea of, okay, you know, you've been up in, if you want to call it heaven or wherever your euphoria or wherever you wanted to go is where your consciousness is. And then I guess it's almost like people, either they had unfinished business or even some of them get bored and they're like, you know what, I want to go back and do that ride again. So go ahead and wipe my hard drive clean, you know, and maybe a little of it carries over and stick me back down and let me try this all over again. That's almost the way it kind of seems at times.
Well, that's right. So there are traditions in some countries where people talk about, for instance, the fruit of forgetfulness or some sort of food where people are supposed to eat it so that they'll forget their past life and then start over again. But then some of these kids will talk about how they didn't swallow the food or whatever, and then they have the memories as they start up a new life.
So it's kind of their tale of the area of where they were raised. I know everybody that talks against it and doesn't believe in anything that has to do with past lives or reincarnation always says that, well, there's more people on Earth now than there was 1,000 years ago, so there's no way they can keep reissuing. They have to be new souls or new consciousness and all that. But I guess, why can't it be both? You know, it seems like there has to be new and old. I mean, it just seems like an awful waste of consciousness and energy if you can't come back and have a little fun every now and then.
Well, that's right. There certainly can be new. But regardless, I mean, with population growth, I mean, there are a lot more people who have lived and died than there are living now. So the estimates I've seen are about 105 billion people have died, and, you know, we're at, what, 7 to 8 billion alive. So, I mean, there's certainly enough souls from the past where we all could have past lives. It would mean that we'd be coming back more quickly now than in the past when there were fewer people being born. But, I mean, the math does work. The math certainly does not disprove reincarnation. But with our cases, they don't necessarily mean that we all reincarnate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in fact, it may be the exception to the rule. I mean, we don't know. It may be when someone dies typically that even if their consciousness survives, it sort of goes to another realm or another level of existence. But with these kids, possibly because of how the previous person died, that they continue on here and have another life.
I don't want this to be a little off topic or even too much speculation, but do you think that some of these past live cases and things, and like you said, maybe everybody has a part of it in them at some point, or do you think that could be what could lead into like the deja vu feelings of people being there before and feeling like certain things, like maybe you have been there before?
Well, certainly people have speculated about that. It's possible, but who knows?
Yeah.
I think deja vu, to some extent, means different things to different people. But I mean, I think a lot of people do have the sense of, well, I've kind of experienced this before. And who knows where that came from. There may well be some sort of neurological kind of explanation for it. But you're right. I mean, there are occasionally people who visit a place that they have never seen before, and it seems incredibly familiar. And sometimes they can even describe what's around the corner or whatever. So with those, you really do have to wonder.
Well, after reading your book, it's made me start watching my children closer. And it made me think of, you know, you always hear every family has this, where like, oh, so-and-so, he walks just like his great-grandfather did, or he throws like his grandfather did, or she talks, you know, just like her great-grandmother did. You know, I also wonder, you know, how much is that? Is that like genetic imprinting, or is it some form of this maybe past lives? It's incredible. Now, also, you talk about how many of these kids have phobias based on how they died in their previous life.
That's right. With the people that, for the previous person, died an unnatural death, about 35% of the kids will have phobias, will have intense fears toward the mode of death. So, for instance, there's a little girl where, from the time of infancy, she hated being in water, and in fact, it would take three adults to hold her down to give her a bath. And then when she got old enough to talk, she described life, and it was one of a little girl in another village who had drowned in an accident. And that's the kind of thing that, like I say, we've seen about 35% of those cases.
It's funny you bring that up, Jim. The minute you said that, Kyle pointed directly at me, because I shower, and that's as close as I don't like to swim. I don't get in the ocean. I don't get in anything that you soak in at all. I do not. And it's started out as when I was young. I didn't really enjoy it. And as I've gotten older, I enjoy it even less. It's just something about it. And I don't know if I don't have any memory because I'm an old man now, but I'm not nowhere. That may be a good explanation. I'm going to start saying that. I'm going to start saying that I died in a past life around water. Oh, that would be able to get off my back.
Now you know how you die in your past life.
That's right.
Now, do you ever have anybody claiming that when these children have these remembrances, that it's just they are possessed, it's like possession, or they have ESP, like they're able to psychically pick up what their parents are wanting them to say, or something paranormal?
Well, certainly in the field of parapsychology, people have offered those kinds of explanations. Not necessarily that they're picking up psychically what the parents want, because the children are often describing lives the parents didn't know the people either. But the question is whether they could in some psychic way be connecting with this collection of memories. I think there are reasons to doubt that. Partly, there's this such a strong emotional component. I mean, it's not just a collection of facts that these kids have, but it really, from their viewpoint, is very much experiences that they had. And also, most of the kids, at least by the family's reports, have no other psychic experiences or psychic abilities. So it would be odd that they would just have this tremendous psychic link with one person who died. But yeah, I mean, we, yeah, I think what we can say is that, that these, the strongest cases offer pretty decent evidence that some children do have memories from the life of someone who's lived before. And, you know, while I think the most obvious explanation is that they lived that life before, there are other explanations that, that need to be considered.
Well, you're right. I mean, it's not merely having a kid sit in a room and can you look at a picture and can you point to your great-grandmother or something. I mean, there's cases in your book where a boy was with his family and he said, I used to live down this road, and they take him down the road and they go to the house and they meet the people that live in that house. And he knows the names of like seven or eight people, and he even knows a gift that he gave to one of the men on that man's birthday. And I mean, it was like a pistol or something that no one else would know.
Well, that's right. In fact, there's one case Ian studied where the girl came out with 25 proper names and the relationship of that person to the one who had died.
You can't
and
get that, lucky I mean, like so, that. That. There's so something there.
That's not coincidence. No. Whatever the explanation may be. So, yeah, they, I mean, ones like these, they did not pick up the knowledge from anyone around them because no one around them knew it. So it had to come from somewhere else.
Jim, let me ask you this right quick. Put you on the spot. If you had to pick your favorite story that maybe you didn't put in the book, or maybe you just got, or something that really had the biggest impact on you, what would it be?
Well, I think, you know, with my first book, it's more or less kind of a greatest hits collection of the cases that we've collected over now over 50 years. And a lot of those were ones that other people had studied, like Ian Stevenson and also some of our colleagues. With the new book, these are the stories of the cases that I've studied. And so it's been a process for me where I've become impressed with a lot of cases. I think James Leiniger, the one we talked about earlier, where you remember being a World War II pilot, that one's been kind of a tipping point for me, where I think with that one on top of all the others, I think, all right, well, something's going on here. And, you know, that case has gotten some press, and then his parents did write a book about it, which is quite interesting to read. But even if people don't want to read all that, I would encourage someone who's skeptical, read the chapter in my new book about that case and then tell me how you would explain it, because it really is quite phenomenal.
Well, and I'm glad you brought that chapter up, because it's just when they talk about him, the way he used to always get into a vehicle as a little boy, and then they take him to the flight show, and they see why he acts that way is because he has the mannerisms of a pilot. And no little child is going to have these mannerisms. I mean, I don't care.
Well, that's right. I mean, I put him in his seat in the car, the child seat. He would do this motion where he'd bring both hands down and then over his ears and then put one close to his mouth. And they eventually saw what it was. It was like pilots where they put on their pilot's cap and then bring the little microphone piece, the mouthpiece, over to their mouth. So, yeah, I mean, that's only one of many features of that case that really add up to, I think, something quite remarkable.
There's several of those cases that it's always one of those things that, and I'll be honest, is I was on the fence about it. I mean, I know there's got to be something, you know, next level after this. There has to be. But the reincarnation thing, I was like, I don't know. I don't know enough about it and all that. But hearing some of the interviews that you've done and then getting involved with reading the books and the studying the stuff on the internet and everything, I'm just like, that answers the question. There's no more argument. I mean, that's, if anything, that it just feels to me like it really backed up the whole idea of there's plenty more that goes on once you leave this level. And it just, you get to, so I guess if you want to come back, you can. If you don't, you don't have to. It almost answers all the questions that I had, just that little bit.
Well, I think it's pretty persuasive, yeah. Now, again, of course, it doesn't answer the question, really, sort of what you're alluding to, necessarily how much control we have. I mean, it may not always be that it's necessarily your choice whether you come back.
That's true.
and I tend to think of it as sort of a naturalistic kind of process. So if, for instance, with a traumatic death, that there's this kind of pull where the consciousness, there's this emotional pull that doesn't allow it to sort of move on, but keeps it sort of connected again in kind of a naturalistic way where then it attaches to a new body and then continues on with another life.
Now, I know there's no way to substantiate some of the claims, but I have heard people that were claiming that they used to be animals. And do you get very many cases of that?
We don't get very many, but it's more than zero. I mean, in a way, it's surprising. Ian pointed out it's kind of surprising we don't get more in the sense that some of the areas there he collected cases in, it's certainly part of the belief system that that could happen, but he almost never got reports. But we've got a few, and there are a couple in the new book. You know, those cases are sort of uncomfortable to think about a whole lot. But if there is reincarnation where people can come back, it seems to me not impossible that animals would be able to, too. I mean, if our consciousness continues, then presumably animal consciousness can, too. And perhaps in these rare situations, it can kind of move from one species to another.
So with all that we've covered, Jim, what is your take on it now? Have you changed your stance before you went in? Did you already have a pretty good idea of how you felt about like reincarnation and afterlife and things, or has it changed you completely now?
Well, it has certainly changed. I mean,
or has it just reinforced kind of what you thought?
Well, I wouldn't say reinforced. I mean, for most of my life, I had never even thought about reincarnation. And then when I got involved in this work, obviously I was open to the idea or I wouldn't be spending my time doing it.
Exactly.
But I continue to approach each case looking to see how much evidence there is. So I wouldn't say that I've become sort of a zealot or a true believer. Mm-hmm. So with each case, I'm open-minded, but I have become more persuaded that it can be possible for children to have memories of past lives.
Well, doing all the case studies that you've done, I applaud you for being able to do that, for being able to go, you know what, I'm still going to approach this scientifically. I still need to look at this, you know, objectively and not go in there with a made-up idea and just look for reinforcement to that idea. I just have to approach it open-minded and see what it offers me, because all the stuff that you've studied and all the things that we've read, it really does. It seems like there's no way of explaining some of these stories other than the clear and plausible explanation of they've been reborn. They've come back from the other side, and they're here now to relive again.
Well, that's right. It certainly seems that way. But, I mean, in many ways, I tend to be kind of skeptical by nature, and it takes a lot for me to make a definite judgment one way or the other. So I guess that makes a good temperament for these kind of cases where, you know, with each new case, I'm really being skeptical and looking at every potential weakness or every detail and trying to see what I can make out of it.
Now, if anybody has any cases that they want to share with you, what's the best way to get a hold of you?
The easiest way is through my personal website, jimbtucker.com. There's compared to the university website, which has a very long website address. But it's all there for jimbtucker.com, and there's also a contact button to push. And on the university one, most of our articles, our papers that we've published are available as PDFs now on that one. And then on mine, there's some videos of both interviews as well as some of the cases. But like I said, there's definitely the easiest way to contact me is from there.
We're going to put links up for that for sure. Now, both your books, is it like everybody else, do we buy them off Amazon, or can they come and get them off your website?
No, the website has a link to Amazon or to other online booksellers.
Okay.
And hopefully it be in people's local bookstores also.
Are they on Kindle versions and all that stuff as well?
Yeah, there are Kindle versions, and there will be an audiobook version. It's not out yet.
Nice.
But they're definitely the e-books.
Well, they're amazing books. It's Life Before Life, and the new one is Return to Life. By Jim Tucker, and they are amazing. Thank you so much, Jim, for coming on tonight and talking to us about this. Go ahead.
Yeah, don't run away. We want to talk to you a little bit off air.
All right. Well, it's been a real pleasure for me to talk to you guys.
It's been great. We've really enjoyed, like I said, the books, everything. It's been eye-opening. It's one of those things Kyle and I have discussed for several years, some of these strange things like this as far as the reincarnation and things. And, you know, just as you get older, you start really looking into these things. And in finding your information and finding these books has really given us a lot to sit there and chat about. And our wives love it. It's just like everybody that we've come across, we start discussing, is fascinated with the subject. So, folks, if anything, get out there, get the books. You won't be sorry. These books are great.
No, they're amazing.
Oh, well, thank you very much. And thanks for giving the plug to the books.
we're back. What do you think about that?
I loved it, man.
It's incredible, right?
It is. It's an incredible, fascinating story.
Now,
yes.
I have only read one of the books. I read Life Before Life. I haven't. It's funny, by the time we scheduled this interview, his book had just been out.
Yeah.
A couple of weeks. I have not had a chance to read the second one, but I'm going to because...
Well, your wife loves it, too. She was the one that wanted to read the book before you even
read
it. Yeah,
I had to hurry up and knock it out in 3 days because she's been chomping at the bit to read it, and she's been done with it now, too. But fascinating, fascinating topics. I mean, there's no way that these kids can know what they know unless they have experienced some kind of past life.
I know there's one of those things because I was thinking of this the whole time during the interview was, could they have been prompted by their parents?
I'm sure. But well, that's what he talks about. The cases and this stuff, they've already weeded all that out, of course.
Well, that's what I was going to get into was, even he said off air with us before, that they did a lot of that. He looked into a lot of that to make sure that mm-hmm. that wasn't it.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't. There's so much. Now, he knows that there's some that didn't make the book that was, of course, you know, parentally prompted at times. But
yeah.
But not these. These were the ones you're just like, how is this
even possible?
Kid
driving in a car and be like, go down there. I used to live down there. Then they go down there. They knock on the door. And then the guy, he can point to a family photo and he knows like 8 or 9 of the people's names, first and last names, and how they're related. I mean,
this kid putting on his Air Force helmet. Come on now.
Come on, man. It's insane. I like the fact that the habits of their former life carry over. So like a little kid wants to like to drink alcohol and smoke cigarettes because that's what the other guy did.
That or it's just because it's cool to do.
Smoking is not considered near as bad in a lot of those third world countries like it is over here.
No, yeah. I don't think they get the information that we get.
No.
For sure.
Speaking of some new news, though, for the show, we are now available on several other platforms other than just iTunes.
Yes.
For a long time, people have been throwing stuff at us, and it wasn't really until I talked to Jim Harold about moving on and getting on Stitcher and some of the things. So now you can find us almost everywhere. You can go to our website, www.expandedperspectives.com. You can go to iTunes. You can go to TuneIn. You can go to Podbay. You can go to Stitcher. You can go Beyond Pod or whatever. There's no way that you can't find our show. You know, if you have an Android phone.
There's an app for every mobile device.
Yes, there's an app, and we're enlisted on all of them. And thank you so much for the people that have been writing reviews for the show. We always ask people to do that, and it really does help us out. I noticed a lot of new reviews on there. Emma Fulton put one up on iTunes. Another fella out of the UK on our Herod 69, he put a review up over there.
Thank you so much.
Also, I noticed that Stitcher has a totally new rate and review segment.
So it's separate.
Separate. So you might want to go in there and write some reviews if you're a Stitcher listener.
Yeah, please do. If you listen
whatever the feedback,
Stitcher,
man,
please.
It really helps us out because, like we've said before, when you search for podcasts, the better the review, the higher you are on that list, and it makes us more available. But I really appreciate everybody doing that. We're getting lots of followers on Twitter. We get a lot of followers on Facebook. We've been getting emails from people. People have been sending us links to stories. And that's exactly what we like. Please, if you find anything interesting, email it to us, man. We love that.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of emails, I got one from a woman named Becca, and she's from El Paso.
Oh, nice.
Becca just found us from Jim Harold's show.
Oh, wow.
So she was a big Jim Harold listener. She found it, and she says she really enjoys the show. She really loves it. So, Becca, thank you so much for the kind words you emailed us.
Yeah, thank you.
I've been to El Paso a few times. My son wrestled out there for regionals 2 years. Oh, this has been several years ago, but we had to go out there for 2 separate years. In his freshman and sophomore year, he made regionals, and we had to go out there and wrestle. And the first time we was on the military base, and the second time, I wished I could remember the school, but it was literally you walked out of the high school down to the soccer field, and you could throw a baseball over the Red River. I mean, it was right. I mean, it was like right
there. What's funny about that town is like one side of that river is like one of the safest places in America.
Yeah.
Or in the world, I'm sorry. And then the other side of the
most dangerous. Yeah. But we drove out there both times, and she's talking about driving, you know, through that. And by the time you take I-20, the lid hits Interstate 10 out there, and you start running down there on Van Horn and all that, there's nothing.
There's nothing.
I mean, there's nothing, folks. People, for those of you that's not from Texas or have never been down here, when you see movies, there's a Tommy Lee Jones movie called The Three Burials of Melquiades Estrada. If you watch that movie, that's exactly what it looks like. Pretty much, well, it's filmed in Van Horn. It's filmed around, apparently, Tommy Lee Jones has some land down there.
It's cheap.
It is vast, rugged land down there. Yeah, I mean, it is.
$10 an acre, I heard.
So
I mean,
there's no telling. Yeah, there's no telling. But yes, Becca, thank you so much again for the kind words, and thanks for joining us, and I hope you can stick around and enjoy it. Tell your friends and, you know, everybody else you know, and yeah, bring them all on. Kyle, I would love to tell you what I plan on doing for the next episode before we get going. I don't know, though, man. I'm up in the air. I've got a bunch of stories I want to talk about for the next episode, but I can't make up my mind. So it's going to be me shaking the magic eight ball and just giving her hell trying to see what it comes up and says.
I got you, man. I know what I'm doing, but I'm not going to tell you yet.
You, man, I see. I tried, folks. I tried to stump him up and get him to go ahead and spill his beans, but he wouldn't.
I don't
do
want
it.
People to research what I'm doing and then do the headstone and then try and then, to call me out
and
on
then
it.
Bust your balls on it. Yeah. Yeah. It happens.
Oh, it happens all the time. Hey, look, I'm no expert. It. I don't, you know, I don't pretend to be. This show is for entertainment only. Yeah. In case you didn't know.
Oh, yeah. It's entertaining just to watch us fumble and stumble.
I like the way your excellent pronunciation of that movie.
What, the Spanish?
Yeah.
Oh, come on, man. It's.
I didn't know you could talk like that.
It's part of the state. I used to, man, I'm telling you, I used to be able to speak quite a bit of Spanish.
Just curse words, right?
Well, no, I could carry on. Yeah, that's what I learned first. But I could carry on a pretty decent conversation. But it's been so long since I've used it that it's one of those things that I need to, I'd like to get back to it. I'd like to learn Portuguese. I'm really thinking about leaning more, trying there to learn that. But I don't know. Portuguese and Spanish, they're pretty close to the same, I suppose.
They are similar.
But, you know, I mean, they really are similar, but I don't know. I mean, the Spanish is just, Spanish would help me out, you know, help you out more here, but it's just, it's part of Texas. That's just what it is.
I like to learn Mandarin Chinese.
I love that commercial that you bring that up.
Yeah, that's what I thought about it.
Yeah. With the cowboy, folks, if y'all don't know, we're talking about like some crazy internet commercial where the guy's some cowboy out on the range and he's watching kung fu movies that me and Kyle used to love to watch as kids. Yeah. Yeah, that kind of stuff is awesome. It was awesome. Philly? What else you got? Anything?
Nothing, man. I'm going to be, like I said earlier, I'm going to be waiting and cheering on Team USA in the men's ice hockey division. I don't think we're going to do that good, but our first game against Slovenia, I think, or Slovakia, I don't know which. And then we got Russia in our bracket, too, so that's never good.
That's really funny, because I heard you was rooting for Sidney Crosby and the Canadian team.
No, sir. Nothing could be further from the truth.
Folks, for those, I wish there was a camera in here so you could see his face right now. I'm not going to ag him on anymore, but that's... You really
no,
wanna,
I mean, I don't want to lose every Canadian listener we
you
have.
You want to put a thorn in Kyle's side? Somebody send him a Sidney Crosby shirt. Send him one that's a cap. We'll get him to get his picture made in it, get his number, get his sticker.
I'll put his sticker
on his car.
No. That's not, you'll never catch me in
you
that
don't know
shirt.
How mad he is right now looking at me.
I'm not mad. I'm just, you know, I'm still bitter from the last Olympics, to be honest.
Stop.
Oh, yeah, I'm not even going to bring it up. I'm not bringing it up.
See, look what I've done.
Hey, I love Canadians. I've been to Canada like 4 or 5 times. Great country, and I'm sure Sidney is a very nice man.
But you just don't like him.
No, I think he cries a lot.
Here we go.
let's move on.
Yeah. See. Well,
so what else? You're going on a ski trip.
I'm going to Colorado. Yeah, we're going
to
run.
Next Monday episode when it comes out, you won't even be here.
No, I'll be on the road home at that point.
You'll be able to listen to it. You should try one of those new apps.
You know what? I might do that. I really might do that. I may sling it out. I may try some Stitcher or something like that while I'm up there and see how it comes out and the whole deal. But yeah, I'll be posting some pictures on Twitter. And I'll be throwing some up on Facebook and stuff like that while we're up there. I can't wait. We're going to go up there and ski. And I'm going to do a little skiing. Not a whole lot, you know. I'm old. So I don't want to get too stove up. But I am going to do some snowmobiling. Man, I've never got the snowmobile.
Actually, I've snowmobiled exactly the same town you're going
to. Where we're going, yeah.
It was really neat. I had a lot of fun.
Now, I've messed around with them, but you know, whenever we've been up there, but never really run around in the mountains.
It's kind of like a four-wheeler.
So I'm looking forward to that. Looking forward to that stuff. So we'll be up there. So, yeah, it'll be fun, I guess. I love the cold.
Don't forget to check Cam out on Jim Harrell's Campfire podcast.
Yep.
That was really neat. If you don't, you know, check us out anywhere you can, man. Go to our website. Follow us. Tell your friends. Rate, review the show, as always.
You can find us on Twitter. You can find us on Facebook. You know, you can find me and Kyle on Facebook. Both of us separately on Twitter and on the website. So,
I mean, you can join my private Facebook page. I'll accept your friend request.
He's boring.
It's nothing's on there, but, you know, just pictures of my kids and stuff. But
yeah, he's boring. He's as boring as I am. We're not that exciting, folks, but we love the friendship. So, yeah, keep sending them. I keep getting them. I keep sending them, guys. I mean, I've got a bunch of them coming in. Keep coming, man. It's part of the family. So all the listeners that support us like that, I do. I consider y'all like part of my family. It's great. I really do enjoy it. And I hope that one day we get to run into some of y'all and we can all sit around and have a few drinks and laugh and tell stories and slap each other on the back and giggle and everything. I mean, it's a great thing. So thanks for sticking around with all this.
All right, man. Thank you. And please don't break your legs when you're up there.
I'll be good. Yeah, I'll be all right. I'm not going to twist an ankle. I'm not going to do anything crazy while I'm up there. I'm pretty well laid back. Pretty well laid back. Folks, whatever you do, y'all stay safe. And we'll see y'all again Monday.
Peace.
satisfied.